Hello students, welcome to lecture 2 of this VLSI design course. As I have already told you about the VLSI technology, I do understand that all these things are not that easy for you because everything is new for you, new nomenclature, all the technologies, everything is new for you. So you might be a little confused about these things, right? So what I recommend, not to worry much, please don't worry, because the syllabus which have been designed at undergraduate level for BTech level, it's so easy that these things are just introductory which I am telling about. So including my last two lectures and even this lecture, fine, and a lecture another lecture apart from this, at least four lecture, that would be introduction to VLSI, fine, and that may include very new terms which may be confusing for you, but they are very important as far as VLSI is concerned. If you have to study VLSI, you have to understand these terminologies, fine. So please don't get confused, please don't get confused that how will you remember all these things. These are very new concepts for you people, but don't worry, as the lectures will go forward, you'll get to understand that what I am able to trying to teach you, fine. So in this lecture I'll be talking about the different VLSI designs, various VLSI designs which can be which are in various integrated circuits which are designed, and then I'll be telling about the fabrication technology, because that is very important. Although please remember, these things are not in your syllabus, but why I am telling you, because after studying this VLSI design course, you should be able to tell the basics of VLSI technology. Let me be very clear in this course that you have to study only and only CMOS based integrated circuit. This is how I have designed the syllabus of this undergraduate VLSI technology, because understanding the VLSI technology needs a higher level of thinking, and at the undergraduate level it's not possible. So what I have done, I have only kept CMOS based circuits as your syllabus, and what I am teaching as of now is all about VLSI technology, which is not as a part of your syllabus, but still you need to understand this because you are doing a course on VLSI, fine. And I'll summarize this VLSI technology by next lecture, so that from next to next lecture you'll start your CMOS integrated circuit, fine. That is your syllabus. Your syllabus is actually CMOS integrated circuit, but what I am teaching now is VLSI technology, the basics of VLSI technology, that is very very important for you, fine. So let's start it. These are the different design styles. Actually, there are many ways by which you can design your integrated circuit, your ICs, fine. The three main ways are full custom, semi-custom and programmable, fine. It's in front of you. Full custom, semi-custom and programmable. Full custom, as the name suggests, custom means depends upon you, depends upon the user. Full custom means as the user wants, starting from the scratch, as the user want, they can design their integrated circuit. Semi-custom means a little is in hand of the user and rest is in the hand of manufacturer, fine. And then programmable means the ICs have already been manufactured, you just need to program it and use it. So this is your category of IC: full custom, semi custom and programmable. So before going on to that, I think I should introduce the IC fabrication technology in front of you, fine. So let's go towards IC fabrication technology, because of that some concepts might be very useful for that, for understanding these different types of IC technology, fine. So let's go to the IC technology. Now what I am trying to teach in IC technology, please do to concentrate on the slide which I am trying to teach. I'm trying to teach that just a second, I'm trying to teach that this is a silicon, a simple silicon. What happens when you try to fabricate the integrated circuit? You have a simple silicon, a silicon wafer, a plain silicon wafer, fine, undoped, you know, doping, undoping. So you have an undoped wafer, fine, a simple silicon wafer, and then on that particular silicon wafer you so what I'm trying to tell you that you have a IC, you have a wafer here, we call it as a wafer, fine, a simple silicon, a silicon piece of silicon, a piece of silicon which is used for fabrication purpose, which is used for designing the integrated circuit, is known as a wafer, fine, it's not enough, it's known as a wafer. So you have a wafer, and on that particular wafer you cannot put that small transistor which I have told you in the last class. So what you do, you fabricate those transistors onto the wafer. So there are some methodologies, there are some technologies, by using those technology you can etch, it's not as etching, I'll let you know. So you can etch those transistors onto those IC, fine, and once you etch those transistor you will be able to connect the transistors, and then you will be able to design the circuits on it IC. And once the circuits are designed, you provide the input and output pins and your IC is complete. This is how you proceed, fine. And let's see this here, that what you are trying to do on the IC. Let's see it's here. On an IC you are trying to see, you took this as a silicon wafer, fine, this is a silicon wafer, then what you, so this is a wafer in front of you. Now on this same wafer you wanted to introduce all the transistors. So what type of transistors are on an IC? They are basically only CMOS. This I have already told you in the last classes, they are CMOS, fine, and specifically in the CMOS they can be either NMOS or they can be either PMOS, fine. So how to etch PMOS and NMOS on a silicon wafer, fine, how to do that? What you do, you wanted a NMOS and a PMOS on a same silicon wafer. So remember, this is a silicon wafer, just a second, so this is a silicon wafer, fine. Now just a second, I'm sorry, this is a silicon wafer. So what you are trying to do, you wanted to etch a PMOS and a NMOS on this. So you have to etch the NMOS and PMOS both on the same IC, fine. So how to etch the NMOS and PMOS, look here very clearly. What you do, you etch, for example, you make this wafer as p-type, you make this wafer as p-type, complete wafer as p-type, fine, you make this complete wafer as p-type, and now what you do, you make it two regions as n plus means n-type, heavily n-type, and make this region as n-type, keep this region as p-type only, so that this will start acting as source, this will start acting as drain, and when you etch an oxide layer on this and connect a metal terminal, it may work as a gate. So a NMOS is in ready in front of you on an IC. Similarly, what you can do, you make a box kind of thing, this is known as well, fine, this is known as well. So what you do, you make it is as n-type, fine, this is known as well. So you are kind of creating a well, fine. So when you make it n-type, and make this much region as p-type and this much region as p-type, heavily p-type, heavily, fine. So now what will happen, this is n-type, this is p-type, and this is p-type. So when you put the terminals like this, along with silicon oxide. So this will behave as a PMOS. So on the same integrated circuit, on the same IC, you're able to fabricate both NMOS as well as PMOS. Fine. So this is the actual way of fabrication, or this is the way you are fabricating on an integrated on a wafer. Fine. So let's see the same thing using the slides. So in front of you, you are having a p-type substrate. Look very clearly, this blue box will shows you a p-type substrate. That means a substrate means a silicon box which is made of silicon. Fine. It's not exactly a box, a very thin wafer. It is p-type lobe, so it is known as p-substrate. Fine. Let's go forward. Then it is oxidized. It is what? It is silicon. You all know it is silicon. This is what? A silicon. Just a second. This is a silicon. This is silicon. When you give oxygen to it, when you supply oxygen to it, what will happen? In certain conditions, what will happen? It will become silicon oxide. Fine. So you provide the oxygen for that limited amount of time because you need this much amount of oxide on silicon. Fine. Then move forward. Then you put a photoresist. So please remember, it's not on your syllabus, so don't get confused. Just try to understand what is IC fabrication. Fine. Because it's not in your syllabus, so it will not ask in your exams, so you need not to mug it up. Okay, you just have to understand how the IC fabrication takes place. Fine. Now after oxidation, what will happen? Photoresist is put on you. What is photoresist? Photoresist is a kind of solution or is a kind of material which becomes soluble when you put it when you wash it with a particular solution. For example, there are two types of photoresist. Fine. Let me explain you. There are two types of photoresist. Negative photoresist. Just a second. I'm telling you. There are two types of photoresist. There are two types of photoresist, negative photoresist and positive photoresist. So what happened when you put photoresist here, and please understand carefully, you expose, see, if you want to etch something here, for example, you want NMOS here and you want PMOS here. So what you have to do, you have to remove this much amount of area. Fine. You have to remove this much amount of area. So for removing this much amount of area, what you have to do, you take a mask. This is what? A mask, a layered mask which has a gap, this much amount of air. How much? This much amount of gap. Then you put ultraviolet rays here, please remember. Then you put ultraviolet rays, UV rays here, and because of UV rays, what will happen? This much amount of photoresist will become soluble. Fine. This much amount of photoresist will become soluble. Soluble means when you wash this with a particular acidic solution, it will wash away, and that much amount of silicon will be exposed. Fine. So let's see it here itself. And what is negative and positive photoresist? Just in a single line, I would like to tell you. Positive means if you put ultraviolet light on that photoresist, if it becomes soluble, it is positive photoresist. If you put ultraviolet light on a particular solution, only that particular particular area of photoresist which is exposed to ultraviolet light will become unsoluble, and rest of the photoresist becomes soluble. That is known as negative photoresist. Fine. So let's move forward. We'll see the same thing which I have explained you. This much amount of area I have chosen, this much amount of area I have chosen for fabricating the PMOS. Let's say PMOS. Fine. So what I've done, I've chosen a mask in which I have this much amount of gap, because I want to fabricate PMOS here. So purposely I have chosen a mask which has this much amount of gap. Now I put ultraviolet light on this. So what will happen? This much amount of photoresist becomes soluble. Fine. Now what will, this is known as, this process is known as photolithography. Please remember. Please remember, it may be asked somewhere, not in the undergraduate exam, because this is not a part of your syllabus, but it might be asked anywhere. Fine. What this process is known as? This process is known as photolithography. Fine. Photolithography. Now what will happen, this much amount of area is exposed to ultraviolet light, so it becomes soluble. Now you remove this photoresist. You remove the photoresist by a particular solution. It can be any solution, acidic, basic solution, depends upon the type of fabrication you are doing. So it is dissolved. Then further you remove the exposed SiO2. Fine. So what happened now? A particular area of silicon is exposed. Now you can fabricate a particular transistor here and a particular transistor here. Let's see how it is done. You remove the remaining photoresist, because photoresist is of no use. In a CMOS, there is silicon, there is drain, source, oxide. That's it. There is no photoresist. So you need not photoresist anymore. You may remove the excess photoresist. Then you create a anvil. Fine. What is anvil? In a p-type substrate, what you do, by the process of diffusion, you put pentavalent impurity. How to make a semiconductor n-type? Please remember. If you remember from your electronics 1 and electronics 2 courses, how to make a n-type semiconductor? By doping it with pentavalent impurity. So what you do, you put pentavalent impurity here. Fine. And pentavalent impurity for how much time? For a particular amount of time, so that this much amount of area becomes completely n. Fine. And the rest of the area remain p type. So this much amount of area become n type. Fine. And I call this area as n well. Why n well? Because this is a kind of well inside n type well inside a p type substrate. This much amount of p type substrate, but this much amount of area is n well. Fine. This much amount of area is n type. So I call it as a well inside a p substrate. Fine. Now what I'll do, I clear the remaining SiO2 also, because I have to create, please remember, I have to create some drain area and source area. Please remember, in your electronics 2 and electronics 1 course, how you develop a CMOS, you have drain, source and gate. Fine. So to make drain and source, you have to remove the silicon oxide, because silicon oxide does not combine with any other material. So you have to remove the silicon oxide. Fine. Afterwards, when you have finished making drain and source, then you will make the silicon oxide. Fine. So let's move forward. In this step, what you have done? You have removed the silicon oxide, complete silicon oxide. Now what is remaining? A complete p-type substrate. What is remaining? A complete p-type substrate and a small anvil inside the p-type substrate. Fine. Let's move forward. Then what you do, you make a thin, very thin gate oxide layer. See what is in front of you, a very thin gate oxide layer. This yellow portion is gate oxide. How you do that? It's not explained in this slide, because it's very easy, by doing the oxidation in a particular environment, heating environment or any kind of environment. If you do the oxidation, the silicon becomes silicon oxide. Fine. So a thin layer of silicon oxide, and then a polysilicon layer. What is a polysilicon layer? In case of integrated circuit, for making the connections between the various transistors. Please remember, for making the connection between various transistors, we use polysilicon layer. we use polysilicon layer. What is polysilicon? It is a layered silicon. This is what? This is a silicon substrate. Fine. And this is what? This is the layers, multi layers of silicon. One layer, put on another layer, put on another layer, put on another layer, put on another layer. So such kind of composite material is known as polysilicon. Poly means multi and silicon means simple silicon wafer. So when you keep on stacking silicon wafer on one or another, it becomes polysilicon. Polysilicon is highly conductive, that's why we use it as a connection between transistors. So let's move forward. Until now, what you are having? A P substrate, a n-type well, a oxide layer, very thin oxide layer, and a polysilicon layer on that. Fine, let's move forward. Then again you put ultraviolet rays. Ultraviolet rays along with some photoresist. Look at this. Again you are doing photolithography. Remember, you have already done photolithography for what purpose? For creating this n well. You have already done one time photolithography for creating this n well. Now it is already done. Now you are again doing the photolithography. For what purpose? Let's see. You are again doing the photolithography with this much amount of mask. This is a small, very small mask. And what kind of mask it is? It is a mask of length of gate. Length of gate. Please remember, gate, what gate? Gate of CMOS. CMOS has three terminals, drain, source and gate. So up to the length of gate, the size of this mask is up to the gate length of the gate. Fine. So what will happen? The ultraviolet rays which are here, they will make this much amount soluble. Fine. This they will make this much amount of soluble, and rest of the amount is unsoluble. So what we'll do? See, it has made this much amount soluble, this much amount soluble, and this much amount also soluble, and rest of the amount which is not exposed to ultraviolet, it is unsoluble. So what we do? We dissolve everything. We dissolve which was soluble, and what is remaining? Remaining you have a very thin layer of silicon oxide, very thin layer of silicon oxide, very thin layer of silicon oxide, and a thick layer of polysilicon. So what is this? This will behave as a gate terminal of your CMOS. Because how the gate terminal of CMOS behaves? You have a channel here. Please remember, in your electronics one and electronics course, electronics 2 course, you have a channel here. In above the channel you have a oxide layer, what you call it as non-conducting layer. Fine. Silicon oxide non-conducting layer, or gate oxide, you also call it as a gate oxide. You have a silicon oxide here, and then upon that you have a gate terminal through polysilicon. Fine. So this brown material is polysilicon, and similarly this would be for gate terminal for your PMOS. Let's move forward. Now you put thick gate oxide on this. Fine. Then again you do the photolithography. So this is the third time you are doing the photolithography. How complex this CMOS fabrication is. Look. So now what you are trying to do? Before doing any step, please understand what you are trying to do. Here what you are trying to do? You are trying to make the gap for source and drain terminal. You have already made gate terminal. You have to make source and drain terminal. So with this photolithography, what you are trying to do? You are trying to make the source and drain terminal. Fine. So again with the photolithography, you wash this much amount, this much area away. Fine. Which area has been washed? This much amount of area has been washed. This much amount of area. This is gate. Fine. So you need not to remove anything from here. You have removed this area and this area. Fine. So this area will be used for source and drain of NMOS. Why NMOS? I am telling why NMOS. Because this is a P substrate. For creating a NMOS, you need a P type substrate. And for creating a PMOS, you need N type substrate. Fine. If you remember in your electronics 1 course. If you do not remember, I'll make you study in my next lectures. This is just the IC fabrication. Fine, this is not about CMOS. So let's move forward. Now what you have done? From this slide to this slide, what you have done? It's very easy. You have doped what type of impurity? Pentavalent impurity. What you have done? You have doped pentavalent impurity here. Look, you have doped pentavalent impurity here, so that this area became n-type, heavily n-type. You have also doped n-type impurity here. Why you have doped this one? I will tell you, because this is source and drain. And why you have doped here? I will tell you in next slide. So similarly, some steps have been skipped. What you have done after this? After this, you again do the photolithography for the fourth time. So that why you are doing photolithography now? By doing the photolithography, you remove this and this area, because you wanted the source and drain here also. Fine. So you have removed this area, and then you diffuse, you make it as a trivalent impurity. You make it as a n-type by doping it. What? Trivalent impurity. It will become p-type. Fine. So this is has been done. What has been done? This was already done, gate and source. This was already done. Now you wash this area and this area. Fine. And then dope it with trivalent impurity. And because of doping with trivalent impurity, what will happen? This much area will become p-type. Because with doping with trivalent impurity, your semiconductor will become p-type. Fine. So this will become p-type. Fine. So this will act as a source and gate of what? Of what? Of PMOS. Why PMOS? Because this is p-type and this is p-type. And in a p-type semiconductor, what is the charge carrier? The charge carriers are holes. Fine. And in what type of transistor the holes are charge carriers? In PMOS. So it's very easy to look from here. This is PMOS, because drain and source are p-type. Here the drain and source are n-type. This is drain, this is source. Drain and source are n-type. So this will be your n-MOS. Fine. Let's move forward. Still it is not complete. Let's move forward, because we have to know about this. What is this terminal and this terminal? Fine. Now you do the metallization. What is metallization? Providing the contact, because you have already made source and drain and gate also. Now you have to provide the connection between those drain, gate, drain, source and gate from one transistor to another transistor on the IC. So for that purpose, what will you use? You will use metal. So the preferred metal is aluminium. You make a layer of aluminium, and then wherever you need aluminium, keep it there and remove from other side. The same thing has been done in front of you. We need aluminium only here and here. Fine. So this has been connected. See, I'll explain you. We need aluminium only here. Fine. So this has been connected and rest has been dissolved. Now you put terminals on it. Fine. So see, the terminals has been put. This is, and this will explain you everything. Fine. So let's quickly understand what is this. This is your NMOS, because it has n-type source, n-type drain, and then a gate contact here. Fine. This is your PMOS, because your substrate is n-type. Remember, in a CMOS, the channel is always inverted. It is of always a opposite type. Fine. If it is a PMOS, then the channel should be of n-type, then only the inversion condition will occur. What is inversion? I'll let you know in my next class. I will be teaching you CMOS, but this is just for the purpose of understanding how the IC fabrication takes place. Fine. So p-type semiconductor, definitely it's a PMOS. Fine. Drain, source of PMOS, and gate of CMOS. Now you know the PMOS and NMOS are four terminal device. It's not three terminal device, it's a four terminal device. There is also one terminal which is the substrate. this substrate. This substrate should be connected to somewhere, and that is known as the substrate terminal. So how you have made the connection from the IC in the outer environment, you have fabricated this terminal, and this terminal is known as substrate. Substrate of what? Substrate terminal. Substrate terminal of what? Substrate terminal of PMOS. And this terminal is known as substrate terminal of what? Of NMOS. And it's done. This is how you are able to fabricate your PMOS as well as NMOS on the IC. And this is the very reason why CMOS is preferred over other types of transistor, like your BJT. This CMOS looks very typical, but I assure you, this is the most easiest way to fabricate a transistor on an IC. Fine. And for other transistor, it's little difficult. That's why what you do, you make these transistor on this IC, PMOS and NMOS. Fine. So what you have studied till now, you got to know that how this NMOS and PMOS can be fabricated on a silicon wafer. This I wanted to tell you. Fine. Now what you do, each time you have done a photolithography, please remember one thing out of this lecture. Each time you have done photolithography, fine. For doing the photolithography, you need a mask. Look at here. You are doing photolithography here. Fine. So what you are using? You are using a mask. So each time you do the photolithography, you use a mask. Fine. So what happens? You design the integrated circuit using the computers. That is known as CAD for VLSI. Computer aided design. CAD. Fine. So using the CAD tool, what you do? You simulate your CMOS based circuits, what we are doing in the VLSI lab in this undergraduate course. You simulate the CMOS circuits and then make the layout. Layout means what? All those masks which will be used for fabricating the IC. That is known as layout. I told you in the last class that I'll be telling what is layout. This is the layout. Fine. All those masks, since you are using different masks, so all those masks will be one above the other. How will you differentiate between the masks? All masks will have different colors. That is the layout designing. Fine. Even in today's class or in this lecture, I will be telling you some examples where will you see the mask, original mask, that how the masks are used. Fine. So let's move forward. So till now you have studied the process of fabrication, the process of IC fabrication. Fine. Now I think you are comfortable with IC fabrication and also layout. What is layout? Fine. I'll again explain you what is layout. The layers of mask used for photolithography purpose, when you combine all those layers, that makes a layout. Fine. We will see in this lecture what is a layout. Fine. So in this lecture, what we are studying, this is the last lecture of your VLSI technology. This would be a last lecture of your VLSI technology. From the next lecture, we'll be studying the CMOS transistor. Fine. That is your actual syllabus. Fine. Now, in this class, I would like to tell you about the different VLSI designs or different types of ICs which are available in the market. Very simple. So there are three types of ICs which are available in the market: full custom, semi custom and programmable. Fine. What is full custom? Full custom means where the IC is customizable. The name already gives the understanding where the integrated circuit is customizable. That means it is in the hand of the user how the particular user wanted to make its IC. Fine. So starting from the scratch, from the transistor level, the CMOS designer or the user will make the IC. Fine. That is known as full custom. Semi custom, where some of the designs or some of the attributes of that integrated circuit, like for example mask, like the placing of each transistor, it is already fixed, and user only give the some other attributes like the connection between the circuit. The user only gives the connection between the circuit, or the user only gives the algorithm which will be implemented in the integrated circuit. That is known as semi-custom. Fine. And the third category is programmable. So what does programmable means? In the programmable category, the IC is already pre-made, the IC is completely made, and the only thing which you have to do is to program the IC. You put your program on the IC, and that IC will start behaving in the way you wanted it to behave. Now, here is the difference between the microcontroller, because you all have studied the microprocessor courses, fine. So most of the people who studies VLSI, they always get confused between the programmable type IC and the microcontroller. They think that the microcontroller is similar to programmable based IC, because in microcontroller also, what you do, you provide a program to microcontroller, hai na? So that particular program burns into the, for example, 8051 microcontroller, it burns into the ROM of 8051, and 8051 will start behaving whatever program you have burned into that. Fine. How the programmable IC is different from the microcontroller? In the programmable IC, please listen it carefully. In the programmable IC, what you do? In the programmable IC, you do not give any program. What you do? You provide some electrical signal so that the connection between the transistors, the connections between the transistor has been made. In the microcontroller, you are not doing such thing. In microcontroller, you are providing the assembly language program or C-based program into the ROM. So your already made microcontroller takes the instruction from the ROM and they executes the program. But in programmable integrated circuit like FPGA and CPLD, what is FPGA? I'll let you know. In programmable integrated circuit like FPGA and CPLD, what you do? You provide some modules. They are already made there in the IC. IC is complete. It is into the market. The user only provides some electrical signals so that a particular connection has been made between the transistor. So what will happen now? A complete circuit has been designed using this electrical signal. A circuit will be designed inside the IC, and then you can use that IC for particular purpose. This is the difference between programmable integrated circuit and microcontroller. So let's move forward. So hello students, we were talking about the various VLSI design styles. So let's quickly finish the topic. So I have already talked about the full custom, semi-custom and programmable. I have also told you the difference between the programmable and the microcontroller based integrated circuit. Fine. So let's move forward. This is example of full custom IC design in front of you. Fine. So full custom IC design, what does it mean? Full custom IC design means fully customizable. That means it is in the hand of user that how the user wanted to design the IC. Fine. Starting from the transistor level, the user can design its own IC. Fine. So what the user need to do? The user need to tell the specification that what this IC will do. Then the user will design from the transistor level, which I am telling you in the VLSI lab. Fine. What you are designing? Currently you are designing the inverter, then you will design the AND gate. So this is just an example in the VLSI lab. The real world would be very, very complex as compared to logic gates. So one of the example is in front of you in the slide. This is a circuit. This is a very complex circuit. Fine. So what you do? First you design the schematic, transistor level schematic. This is known as transistor level schematic. Fine. So the very first step is to design the transistor level schematic. So this is the transistor level schematic in front of you. You design the transistor level schematic. Remember, you design the transistor, any IC designer, they design the transistor level schematic using the any one of the VLSI CAD tool. Fine. One of the VLSI CAD tool you are using in the VLSI lab. Fine. So you design the schematic, then you simulate the schematic. Second step is to simulate and check the verification, verify the operation of the semantic. But this is known as spice simulation. Remember, this is known as spice simulation. Fine. So by using the spice simulation, you check whether the input and output waveforms are correct or not, whether your circuit is performing correctly. Then come to second step. Then what you do? Then you make the layout of the your schematic. That is an important part. I have already told you that what is layout. Layout are the set of masks which are used for photolithography. Fine. So this is that. This is in front of you. This is a layout, a typical layout. This is a typical layout, and this layout is always made using VLSI CAD tools. Fine. This layout is always made using VLSI CAD tool. This is one of the layout. So for this circuit, this particular circuit, this layout has been made. See this, these blue lines, these blue lines, these yellow lines, and these small dots. This blue, this black dots. Can you see? These are what? These are layout. Fine. These are layout. They will be used for fabrication of the IC. This is what? This is the schematic. And this schematic is just to check the functionality of the circuit. Fine, not to fabricate the integrated circuit. But this is the layout which will be used for fabricating the integrated circuit. And you can see how it, the complex it can be. And this is very, very difficult to draw with the hand. So, draw it manually. So, what you do? You draw this using a VLSI CAD tool. How you draw it? It's very easy. When you'll see in your VLSI lab, you draw the schematic and your VLSI tool will automatically generate the CMOS layout for you people. Fine, so easy. And then you can send this layout to the IC fabrication industry, and that fabrication industry will design the IC for you. This is the way how the IC fabrication technology works. Fine. So this is how the full this type of IC designing is known as full custom IC design. Why full custom? Because you are fully customizing it, starting from the scratch, from the transistor level till your complete IC has been made. The entire thing is done by the single user. Fine. That's why it is known as full custom. There's one more example of full custom design. There's one more example of full custom design where the layout can be very, very, very complex. See the layout. It's very, very complex. Fine. Now let's come to the second design, that is known as cell based design. Fine. The first one was full custom design, where remember you are starting from the scratch. That means a single transistor, connecting each transistor, then making the layout, then putting then giving the layout to the fabricating company, and then getting the IC. This is the way. In the cell based IC, what you do? You have pre-made cells of some standard logic gates. Like this is the layout. This is, look, this is the layout in front of you. This is the closer view of layout. This is what? This is a 2 input AND gate. This is a D flip flop. This is an inverter. This is a XOR gate. What is this? This is the layout. Fine. So you need not to understand what this red color means, what this blue color means, because that is the work of IC fabricator. That is not your work. Fine. So this, but you need to know what is this. This is a layout. Fine. So in the standard cell design, there is pre-made layouts already available in the CAD tools, VLSI CAD tools. Then you use these pre-made standard cells, and then you join them using the interconnects, and then you can obtain any functionality, any digital functionality. Fine. Because how you made the digital boolean functions, how you make the digital boolean functions, you make the digital boolean functions by connecting the logic gates. Fine. So for that you need the layout of logic gates. So the layout of logic gates are already available in the standard library. So you take the layout of each gate, whichever you need, and combine them. Then you will be able to obtain any functionality. Once your complete layout has been done, then you send it to the fabrication lab to fabricate. So what is the difference between standard cell based design and the full custom design? In the full custom design, you are making the layout of each circuit by your own hand in the CAD tool. And in the standard cell, in the standard cell based design, the standard cells of each gate are already available in the CAD tool. You just use that that layout and design your IC. Fine. Let's move forward. This is one of the example of standard cell design. See, the standard cells are already available in the CAD tool. So you have used standard cell here, then standard cell here. This see, this is a standard latch. This is NAND. If you can read from here, this is again NAND. So you have used the standard cell layout and connected them together to get the standard cell IC. Right? One great example is in front of you. This is a P4 processor. This is a layout of P4 processor. Did you remember Intel P4? Yeah. That is Intel P4 processor layout. This is the L1 cache. It just have one L1 cache. Fine. And this is the ALU and everything. ALU and other floating point units. Fine. So what has been done? This is a single standard cell. This is a single standard cell. This is a single standard cell. All standard cells are interconnected between them to make a complete layout of a complete processor or a complete IC. Fine. This type of IC designing is known as standard cell IC design. Fine. Then come to the next type, that is mask gate array. This is a special kind of IC designing. Although this it was very successful in late 2000s, 2001-2002, but today this type of technology is not used because this is very expensive. Let's see what type of technology is this. In the mask gate array, what you do? First, you have a layout. In the starting, what a designer should have? A designer should have a schematic. From that, he or she will design the layout. Then you put the layout as a mask on the silicon wafer. Fine. And from the silicon wafer, you get a IC. Please remember, from the silicon wafer, you get the IC. So you get the IC, your IC is in front of you. Now what you do? There are some connections which are missing. See, this is the your original layout. The connections between the transistors are yet not done. Only transistors are fabricated, but the connection between the transistor are yet not fabricated. Fine. So in the IC, you just have a IC design. For example, if you wanted a mask gate array type of IC, you are a company owner, you wanted an IC to be designed, thousands IC to be designed, then what happens? The industries, the IC fabrication industry, they are ready with the ready-made ICs, that these ICs are available with us. But these IC will contain these number of transistors at this technology, for example, 32 nanometer technology or 22 nanometer technology. They are already available at the IC designer. The user go to the IC designer and he wants his functionality to be implemented in this IC. So what we'll do? He will just give the contact and metal layers. Contact and metal layers means the connection between the transistors, because transistors are already fabricated. So what the user will give? The user will give his ready-made connection between the transistor. How he will get that connection? That is nothing but the schematic, because he knows his own schematic design. So what he will give? He will give the layout of his schematic. So the IC designer will automatically know where the connection would be made. So in the final design, he will directly do the connection. If you look, these are the connections. It was missing from the original design. So the user gave the connection. So IC designer made the connection into the final design, and finally you have your own IC made from using a IC designer company. This is the way how the mask gate array has been made. Mask gate array was very popular in late 2000, just because of the fact that the full custom IC design, they took very large time to come into the market, because the engineers have to do a lot of research on them, that which technology it should be built. Then these schematics are built by a number of engineers. They simulate those schematic, then layout are generated. So it is a very long process. But in mask gate array kind of design, what you do? Your IC is completely already designed. Only the connection between the transistor are not there. So the user go to the IC designer and he designs IC for you. So the time to market what we call this as the time to market. The design for coming into the market is very short. The time required for the design to come into the market is very, very short as compared to the full custom design. Fine. And the cell-based design, there's also a problem with cell-based design because it contains only standard cells. User-defined cells are not there. So you cannot use your own user-defined functionality into the IC. Only the standard cells are there. So you can only implement the design using standard cells. So there is a limitation there. Fine. So I've explained you all the three types of customizable design. The customizable design, this is known as full custom design, then the standard cell-based design, and the mask gate array. Fine. This is one of the example of mask gate array. Then you go to the next set category of IC design, that is known as programmable array. Programmable, one of the very famous which you can find in any VLSI lab in any institute. Even we also have this in your VLSI lab, but we are not doing this in this semester. That is known as FPGA, Field Programmable Gate Array Design. What are these? Let me explain you. These are nothing but similar to mask gate array. They are nothing but a final product in front of you, an IC. Final IC in front of you. The only thing which is not in that IC is the connection between the transistor. Similar to mask gate array, the connection between the transistor is not there. So what you do, by giving the electrical signals from the inputs of from the terminals of that IC, the connection between the transistor can be made. That's why the name is field programmable. You give an electric field through the input pins, and due to that field due to that electrical signal, the connection between the transistor will be made, and then the connection remains there until you for the time the user wanted to use that IC. As soon as the power goes off, you put off the power, the connection will go off. That means connection means the functionality which you implement on the IC, it will go off. I'll again explain. Field programmable gate array, the name is field programmable. So you give some electric field through the pins of this particular pins of the IC, and by giving the field, electric field, the connection between the transistor, that means the functionality, is implemented onto the IC. Now you can use that IC as a microprocessor. I've seen in some of the NIT, some students have completely designed a processor on a FPGA. Fine. So you can design your FPGA, you can design your random access memory, you can design your DSP processor, anything you can design on FPGA. Only for what time? Only until it is on. Once it becomes off, or if the user wanted to erase, he can erase the data from the FPGA. So it is similar to your microcontroller, where you can put your own program n number of times. The way it will behave, it depends upon the program. Similar is the FPGA. You can design your own circuit on the complete IC as you require. Fine. That is FPGA. And similar is the CPLD and PLD, both things. In FPGA, you have standards. You have standard gates implemented. The connection between the gates are not made. So by electrically, you will make the connection. In CPLD, the cells are already designed. The connection between the cells are not there. So electrically you give the connection between the signals. So this is the category of programmable based ICs. Fine. This is one of the example of programmable based IC, that is FPGA. In FPGA, what happens, you already have the wires, the input output blocks, which will be used for as a pins in the IC. Then you have these horizontal routers. They will have what? This, just ignore this one. These lines, these horizontal and vertical lines. What are these? These are not electrical signal connections. These are standard logic gates. These are standard logic gates. Now between the standard logic gates, there is a kind of matrix. Fine. See, If you wanted a connection between this line and this line, what will we do? You will make this connection, you will make this connection, and you will make this connection. You will have a connection like this. Did you got it? So similar kind of thing, this is known as CLB, configurable logic block. This is known as configurable logic block. So these CLBs are given here. These all are what? CLBs. So by giving the electrical signal from the output, this CLB can be configured and they can be erased also. Fine. So by giving the electrical signal, these CLBs are configured, and they are configured to make the connection between the various logic gates present, already present on the FPG. So you can implement your own function on FPG. Fine. This is about the CLB. Fine. So this is all about the VLSI technology which I wanted to tell you. Fine. Because this terminologies are very, very important for you as you have taken the course as VLSI. Once these all terminologies are clear to you, I have taught you all these terminologies, the basics of this terminology. I have not taken you deep into this because you have to study all these things if you do your master's or PhD in VLSI. You have to study very deep into this. But as a part of your undergraduate level, you just have to understand this much. Now, from the next class itself, what I'll do, we will start your syllabus, that is the CMOS technology. So we will start from the CMOS transistors. Fine. So that is all about this lecture.